In 2023, I made a video called Goodbye Premiere Pro, Why Video Editors Are Leaving for DaVinci Resolve. And that set off a bit of a firestorm online because it resonated with a lot of people. And within a day or two, I had a lot of people from Adobe themselves reaching out to me, leading to me getting invited out to their headquarters in San Francisco about a month later with a lot of other influencers to give them direct feedback about what they were doing wrong and how they could improve. I was really honest with them in my feedback about bugs, crashes, annoyances that a lot of editors were experiencing with the program, and thankfully they listened and took a lot of notes. But here we are, about 2 years later, and I think it's time for an update. So in this video, I want to talk about three things: what Adobe's doing right, what Adobe's doing wrong, and what Adobe's doing that's just downright confusing. Let's start with the good, what they're doing right. 2 years ago, Adobe recognized that Premiere Pro was really starting to lag behind the competition from the likes of DaVinci Resolve and Final Cut, and I truly believe they made a genuine effort to improve their standing in the community. I had the chance to speak to numerous engineers and employees of the company and give them direct feedback, sometimes even reading complaint comments that I'd received on YouTube directly to them, making sure that they saw the concerns of video editors in the hopes that they would do better and improve the program. I also heard repeatedly, time and time again from them, that they were listening. They were taking the concerns of the community seriously, and while they are a publicly traded company, they cannot come right out and say in a formal press release, "Hey, we know we're falling behind our competition. We're going to fix all the bugs and crashes in our system." I want you to notice that in their blog posts throughout 2023, whenever they released a new version of Premiere Pro, they would emphasize how the program is faster than ever before and is the most reliable version of Premiere Pro. They were really doing what they could with corporate speak to emphasize that they were improving as much in the program as quickly as they could. And I will give Adobe credit. From what I could see, for the most part, this was not just lip service. They were really working to make improvements to their software under the hood. For example, one of the biggest complaints that filmmakers have had for many years about Premiere Pro is that the colors when you export a video will look different than how they looked in the video preview. I remember meeting some of Adobe's employees on the Premiere Pro team way back in 2019 at NAB and telling them about this issue. They were aware of it and they released a LUT to fix it, but this always felt like a bit of a band-aid solution. And I heard from many editors over the years that this didn't 100% fix the issue. Finally, in late 2023, Adobe quietly released an update that truly fixes this issue and allows you to change the setting that makes your exported colors look correct, just like in your preview. Side note, by the way, if you're dealing with washed out colors in your exports and you want to correct it, I do have a tutorial that I made that shows you how to update your Premiere Pro settings to make sure that your colors are accurate. I will link to that up in the corner and down in the video description. So it took 4 years since my first complaint, but like I said, this is proof that Adobe has been listening and they have been upgrading Premiere Pro and fixing some of these long-standing bugs. In addition, one thing that I've really been pleased to see is that Adobe has created lines of communication with a lot of insiders and community leaders for Premiere Pro, and they continually offer Zoom calls and updates where they can get feedback on how they're doing. Unfortunately, though, now that we've talked about the good things that Adobe has been doing in regards to Premiere Pro, we now need to shift our attention to the bad things. Because yes, while I think it was great that Adobe invited me out to San Francisco to hear my complaints firsthand, and they were very vocal with a lot of us influencers about how hard they were working to improve the program, if I had to summarize how things were going in 2025, personally, it feels to me like Adobe is, in a word, distracted. See, like I said earlier, Adobe had been focused on stability. They had been focused on bug fixes. But then mid-2023, everything changed. And honestly, everything across the entire tech industry changed. What happened? I'm sure you can guess. AI happened. And every tech company wants to make products that include AI in some form or the other. And Adobe's no exception. Literally, the week after Adobe flew me out to San Francisco to talk about how they were focused on improving the stability and reliability of their products, they released their first Firefly image generation model, and that was just the start. They have continued to push AI, and just like most tech companies, they are very clearly attempting to shoehorn AI into every single product that they can. And if they're anything like any other tech company, which they are, I would bet that the different product teams at Adobe are rewarded for including AI and punished if they don't. Meaning there is a push to include AI features in Premiere Pro, even if that comes at the expense of things like editing and rendering speed and the stability of the program. And here's the truth about things. Even now, 2 years after Adobe committed to making Premiere Pro faster and more stable, if you make an identical project in Premiere Pro and DaVinci Resolve using the exact same video clips and you hit render, the odds are that DaVinci Resolve is still going to render it significantly faster than Premiere Pro. The footage is also going to play back more smoothly on the timeline too, especially 4K 60 and 120 frames per second clips, which a ton of filmmakers are shooting these days because so many cameras are capable of filming at those frame rates. Why is that still true even 2 years later? Why is Premiere Pro still the slowest performing video editing program? It's simple. Adobe is distracted. Instead of focusing on continual improvements and enhanced speed and stability for the program to keep up with their competition, they are devoting the majority of their time and focus to chasing AI features and tools, while the rest of the program is slow and has inconsistent playback and render speeds. Don't get me wrong, new AI features like Generative Extend are cool, but they are still very much so in beta. And at least at the time of recording this video, they are limited to 1080p at 24 frames per second, dramatically lower resolutions than most filmmakers are using these days. In short, these AI tools they're spending so much time on are extremely limited right now. And if we as editors had a choice between Adobe spending a ton of time on flashy AI effects for Premiere Pro or focusing on making their software as fast to edit and render as DaVinci Resolve and Final Cut, I'm betting we would choose option two. It just feels like Adobe chose to waste time trying to generate shareholder value by cramming AI tools into every single product that they make, which the execs want because they're like, AI, that'll make our stock price go up, while they are still far behind their competition in the basics like stability and performance of the tools. This leads us into talking about what Adobe is doing that is downright confusing, because they are spending so much time focusing on AI features. And after a couple of years of them developing their AI, we can see that while Adobe Firefly AI for photos is very impressive, I love using it in Photoshop, the cost in terms of computer power and time to generate AI Firefly videos, on the other hand, is dramatically higher, leading to Adobe, and here's the confusing part, inexplicably wanting to charge even more for their AI video tools. For context, Adobe raised the price of a Creative Cloud All Apps membership to a rather eye-watering $60 per month or $660 per year in late 2023, with all of their software making them approximately $21 billion in 2024 as a company. But here they are introducing AI video generation tools like Adobe Firefly Video Model in early 2025, and that insane amount of money that they made last year from their Creative Cloud subscriptions is not enough. And instead, even if you have a Creative Cloud subscription, you still have a very limited use of this AI video generation tool because Adobe wants you to pay more. Yes, if you have a Creative Cloud All Apps plan, in Adobe's words, you get a whopping two. Yes, two video generations with your plan. You are paying $60 per month and you can only make two AI generated videos on their Firefly website. That's it. If you want to generate more videos than that, Adobe wants you to spend another $10 per month on a Firefly standard plan or $30 more per month for a Firefly Pro plan. And even then, that Firefly Pro plan still only allows you to generate 70 videos. Oh, and that is early access pricing, meaning I assume it will go up. And in addition, Adobe also just added a Firefly Premium plan as well, which is a whopping $200 per month to generate 500 videos. And if you're keeping track, that's a little less than one third of the cost of an annual Creative Cloud plan for just 1 month of access to this generative AI tool. And these videos are 1080p at 24 FPS and only 5 seconds long. It's quite a high cost for such a literal low quality product. And whenever you consider that oftentimes these AI video generation tools are going to hallucinate, meaning you need to generate a video multiple times to get a result that you're happy with, the amount of video credits that Adobe offers is shockingly low. And like I said, it's confusing. Adobe wants you to spend even more money than you are currently spending for a low-quality AI product. Side note, by the way, to be absolutely clear, when I'm talking about these AI video generation tools that Adobe is charging more for, at the time of making this video, their generative extend tool in Premiere Pro is in beta. And as far as I know, you can use it an unlimited amount of times without paying any extra on top of your Creative Cloud subscription. But it remains to be seen if this is going to stay free in the future, or Adobe is going to start to require you to purchase a Firefly add-on plan to keep using it once it's out of beta. I wouldn't put it past them. And this brings us back to competition, which is also one of the reasons that I think my video about video editors leaving Premiere Pro for DaVinci Resolve in 2023 struck such a chord. Because here we are in 2025, where a lot more video editors have switched to DaVinci Resolve. And while Blackmagic keeps adding very cool AI-powered tools to their program, they have not charged any more for these features. And if you want access any of them, all you have to do is pay a $300 one-time fee for the studio version of DaVinci Resolve, or they still offer a free version of the software, which does not have many of these AI tools, but is still a very fast and capable program. And whenever you consider that Adobe's competition from Blackmagic and Apple are offering products that are still arguably faster when it comes to editing and render time than Premiere Pro in 2025, for a price of $300 for Resolve Studio or Final Cut Pro, or free for the basic version of DaVinci Resolve, once you compare that to Adobe charging $60 per month, meaning that you'll pay more than their competition after using their software for only 5 months, not even half a year. And then if you want these new fancy video AI generation tools, they expect you to pay $10 to $30 more on top of that per month. Is there any wonder that video editors keep switching away from Premiere Pro? Adobe started to change for the better in early 2023. I really believe that they want to improve Premiere Pro, but they've also become incredibly distracted by AI. And that's at a time when I and other video editors really want to see them continue to stay focused on stability, speed, and reliability of their video editing software. Personally, I am still planning on creating YouTube tutorials for Premiere Pro. I'm not going to give up on the program because I know there are still so many people out there that use it and who appreciate the tutorials that I make for it. And who knows, maybe Adobe will continue to improve it. We can hope if they're not too distracted. So don't worry, I'm still making Premiere Pro tutorials. But at the same time, I don't have the loyalty to Premiere Pro that I once did. I now know how to use DaVinci Resolve, and I'm working on learning how to use Final Cut as well because I don't want to be committed to just one video editing software. And I also have courses that I've made teaching you how to edit videos in Premiere Pro and DaVinci. I'll link to them in the description if you want to check them out. But I want to hear from you. Where do you stand as a video editor? Are you someone that uses Premiere Pro? Have you considered switching to DaVinci Resolve? Maybe you already use and love Resolve. Or maybe you're over here like, I use Final Cut. It's great. No complaints over here. Let me know in the comments down below. And while you're there, because I want to help you out even more, I've linked to my free guide called Edit Videos Like a Pro. This guide is going to show you some of the biggest tips that I have for you as a video editor. It doesn't matter if you use Premiere Pro, DaVinci Resolve, or Final Cut, these tips will apply, and I know they're going to be helpful to you. You can download them for free at the link down in the video description. Thanks so much for watching. Please subscribe if you want to see more videos about video editing and filmmaking in the future, and have a great day.